Now, the load management committee, we're starting with the first of all with the issue having to do with the country's load shedding. The country's power producers have confirmed what many electricity consumers may have been suspecting for a while now, that there's been some form of power rationing being done on the quiet. The Load Management Committee, in a statement on Friday, said the outages being experienced in the last few days have occurred because there has not been enough electricity to go around, but that they are temporary. The statement does not categorically say that there is power rationing, even though it is easy to infer. Now, let me take you through the statement signed by the chairman of the committee, Engineer William Amuna, the chief executive of the Ghana Grid Company. And it says that the... right, I'll be pulling up that one in a bit. Actually had that one. All right, but we're having all this because of... challenges with the production of gas from the Jubilee fields. And Talo released a statement that says the technical investigation of the conditions of the tired bearing on the FPSO Kwame Nkrumah has confirmed that the bearing has been damaged and it is no longer able to rotate as originally designed. All production and gas export can continue, but under revised operating and offtake procedures. A root cause analysis is ongoing, and a project team is assessing which long-term remediation option is most appropriate. Initial feasibility studies by the team have confirmed that the bearing issue can be fully resolved. So the problem is that because Talo is unable to have to get production or gas production ongoing to supply the Tuabo gas plant for gas to become available to the plants in the generation plants in the Western region, we're going to have some challenges with electricity supply. Essentially, about 1,000 megawatts of plants, or plants that could produce about 1,000 megawatts, are currently lying idle and unable to produce that. As a result, there's been some load shedding. The statement doesn't quite say it's load shedding, but essentially means that there's been some disruptions or interruptions in the electricity supply, and as a result, there's been some outages. Now, the Load Shed Management Committee, the Load Management Committee has come out to apologize, but it says that these challenges are temporary. So we'll try and bring you a bit more on that particular statement when I'm able to eventually pull it out. But in other news, it has emerged that the Electoral Commission's contract with Superlot Technologies Limited, STL, does not include electronic transmission of voting results as claimed by the Interior Minister. The minister, in a statement on the arrest of three South Africans for engaging in acts that threaten the security of the state, indicated that STL is a company contracted by the Electoral Commission to transmit tallied election results. Joy News' Manasseh Azurin, who has been verifying the claims, however, says they cannot be true. He spoke earlier on The Pulse.
What we do know is that STL was engaged in 2012, and in 2016, they will be doing some work for the EC. Now, what has been in contention is the mode through which results are transmitted to the Electoral Commission's head office, or the strong room, from the constituencies. And what we know is that, or what often happens, is that there is a manual delivery of the pink sheets from the polling stations to the collation center, and the addition that is done at the collation center too is done manually. So there's no point that any machines or electronic devices are used normally here. Mm. If there's anything at all, calculators for the addition of the figures. When this is done, the final results are put into some columns in the form and taken to the district data center. Mm. There, it is faxed to the office of the Electoral Commission.
And the district data center is manned by the Electoral Commission?
Yes, it is manned by the Electoral Commission. What STL does at that center or at that level is to provide something like satellite transmission. So when there's no network in that particular constituency or district, what the STL does is to provide the network so that the EC staff at the various districts can transmit. But when we have a district like maybe, or a constituency, like let's say Ablekuma West, and there's that network, they don't even come in. So I just want to run you through exactly what STL did in 2012, or what they were contracted to do, and what they will be doing in 2016 election. In the 2012 election, the STL was contracted for, one, the supply of the registration kit and software.
The biometric equipment.
Yes. And then the second point, the supply of a data center with duplication and database facilities. And what this deduplication machine does is that when they do the registration, it is captured in a memory card. When it is taken to the district electoral offices and it's slotted into some specific or special computers, the information directly or automatically goes to the data center at the EC head office here in Accra. And this particular information is encrypted. So no one can do any altercation or even manipulate this particular information. And then the fourth one, or the third duty or function, that it supplied the verification machines or the verification devices. And four, the supply and maintenance of communication lines for the districts. Like I stated earlier on, if they want to transmit the results and they don't have the network or the phone lines are not working, they provide satellite lines for them to be able to do this. And in 2016, this is what they are going to do. A, or one, to provide services with EC staff or team for the assembling of the kits. We already have the kits, so they're not going to supply them. What they're going to do is to ensure that they are clean and everything is set for the process. The two, we have to supply some software additional fields development. That's when some of them have issues or there is some one or two things that are supposed to be put in place for them to work, or the software, the kits to work effectively, they will supply them. We also have the supply of consumables. Four, supply and maintenance of communication lines in the districts. I've said that if there's no transmission lines, they'll provide that network. And then the device maintenance. When the devices have any problem at any point in time, they come in to do the maintenance. But what they are saying is that at no point in time do they physically have to manipulate or even handle these machines, unless of course there's a problem with a device that they need to repair.
So this clarifies the controversy over whether or not the Superlog Technologies Limited was involved in 2012 in transmitting tallied election results or not, and in fact their function going into this rather crucial election. But
yes, I must also add that in the 2016 we saw that 2016 election, the EC has already advertised that when they want to do that, they want to reduce the manual handling of some of these things, that's the transmission of the results and others. And STL has even not applied for that process. It is 2016 that they want to ensure that some of the tallying and others are automated. But STL has not applied for this process. But as we know in previous elections, what happens is manual addition, subtraction, and all of that. When they finish, they only fax. And STL says it is EC staff who do all of these things. So they don't even come in that process, unless of course there's a problem with the machine, they would have to.
Meanwhile, 8 months to the general elections, the Electoral Commission has reshuffled two of its known faces, the Principal Director of Public Affairs, Sylvia Arno, and the Public Affairs Director, Christian Usupari, have been given different roles to perform. Mr. Usupari has been moved to administration and Sylvia Arno to the protocol desk. The Commission says the two positions are now vacant and have asked staff to apply. Now, three people, including a headmaster of a senior high school, have been arrested by the police in Kumasi for their involvement in examination malpractice. Headmaster of the Ascension School Complex, a private school at Shuria Ekokwashi, a female teacher and a final year student, were arrested for possessing examination materials of the ongoing WASI exams.
Controller of the Kumasi Zone WAEC office, Alex Buapim Busumpim, who briefed the media on the arrest, says police is on the hunt for a fourth person identified only as Jones. The English literature teacher, Esther Boatma, admitted sending already solved questions she received from another teacher through the third accomplice, Adubrefo Priscilla, a WASI candidate. According to Mr. Busumpim, further investigations revealed the head teacher was involved, leading to the arrest of the three on Thursday.
The lady teacher said that she received a WhatsApp message on her phone. The questions were sent to her. So she answered the questions and then wrote the answers on these pieces of paper. She wrote the answers on these pieces of paper and gave the piece of paper to the student. She is also a candidate, but yesterday morning she was not writing. So she gave these pieces of paper with answers to the student.
Some questions in the ongoing West African Senior School Certificate Examination, WASI, leaked hours before the papers were thickened. The papers include physics practical, social studies, integrated science, and oral English. WAEC, in collaboration with the Criminal Investigations Department, deployed a team to the school where there was what was described as a limited spread of the exam papers. The West African Examination Council says it has identified two schools in the Eastern region for engaging in exam malpractice. One of the suspects, Esther Boatma, who describes the incident as a mistake, is pleading for leniency.
The minority spokesperson on education, meanwhile, is calling for the cancellation of the papers that have been compromised in the ongoing West African Senior Secondary Certificates Examination. It follows reports some of the candidates had access to the questions before the start of the exam. Yao Osuwatin believes it is unfair for some candidates to have what the WAEC boss described as foreknowledge of the papers. So Osuwatin was speaking on the Pulse.
I know it disturbs the children who are writing the exams. But for fairness sake, you should cancel it. We are going to write exams. You're all supposed to have prepared. You know the questions. Maybe you even know the answers or for whatever that the boss of WAEC is talking about, foreknowledge. You have foreknowledge. I don't have foreknowledge. Mm. So we don't cancel it. You get A, I get D. I mean, do you think it's fair?
So Wating also wants heads to roll at the West African Examination Council for their failure to curb the trend of leakages and propose some interventions.
The heads to roll. The boss of the Examination Council should be dismissed by now. And then other investigations go into what had happened, what has been happening. And then we punish people. That is the immediate cause, the next step of action, the next solution that we should be thinking of. Then later on, the long-term solution, which is one, we should be thinking whether we need examination council, whether their monopoly should not be neutralized by other rival examination councils. If you go to UK, they call themselves United Kingdom. They have four examination bodies, one for Scotland, one for England, one for Wales, and other, another one, which I don't remember. And then, so we should have rival examination councils so that people take different exams. And then they know that this one, this examination council, they hardly get their papers leaked, so people trust them. So eventually, there will be a flow towards where the examination is tight. If you really want a country where we have truly educated persons who are coming to build this country, not people who are just there, they have certificates and other things purely because, they have A's and B's or only A's and B's, therefore that means they are well educated. Having the grades is just one, but being able to do the work that will help the develop or enhance the development of a country is key. And it is examinations are important. So I've already said one. We can also do a situation where what happens in America. I've even read on the net, not copiously, where Ashasi president is saying that we should even cancel BECE. I think we should cancel one of the alternatives to cancel BECE and SSE, WASI. That if you don't want rival examination boards, you cancel those examinations. So that you go by your this thing, you go by your academic, what is known as academic record. Class one, when you were there, first term, you got this mark, second term, you got this mark, you compile them, and then that is what you are, that to show everybody that you have completed secondary school or you have completed basic school. And then the whole thing is that if the people do not believe that your school or for whatever reason, the area that you attended school or the school that you attended, you cannot trust them, then we have attainment tests. Mm-hmm.
All right, I'd like us to go back to our very first story, which has to do with load shedding. The country's power producers, they've confirmed what many electricity consumers may have been suspecting for a while now, that there's been some form of power rationing being done on the quiet. The Load Management Committee, in a statement on Friday, said the outages being experienced in the last few days have occurred because there's not been enough electricity to go around, but that they are temporary. So let's look at what exactly the statement says. So issued by the chairman of the Load Management Committee, and it says, the Power Sector Load Management Committee wishes to apologize to Ghanaians for the interruptions to electricity supply since the start of this week. The intermittent disruptions have occurred due to challenges in generation resulting from continuing absence of natural gas supply due to the extension of the maintenance works on the FPSO and persistent under-delivery of gas from Nigeria. Now, this is part of the statement we talked about, challenges in generation. Essentially means that there's not enough electricity to go around. And as a result, it would mean that there will be some load shedding. Now, the maintenance works on the FPSO originally scheduled for completion at the end of March this year has now been rescheduled for completion in the last week of April 2016. At the same time, supply from Nigeria has remained at around 10% of contracted volume of 120 million scf for more than a month now. And that is what I refer to as a double whammy. The fact that we're not getting gas from Jubilee and we're also not getting gas from Nigeria. It goes on to say that the above development has led to the inability to generate and evacuate power from about 1,000 megawatts of installed generation capacity, which can only run on natural gas. The situation has been compounded by technical hitch in the conversion of the Bwazi dual-fired TAPCO plant to run on crude oil arising from the shutdown. Now, the Load Management Committee statement makes reference to the extension of maintenance works on the Jubilee FPSO. That mandatory maintenance, which started on Sunday, March 20, was originally supposed to have been completed in 2 weeks, but was extended by a week to Saturday, April 9. Now, Talu, however, released another statement on Friday saying a key component of the FPSO Kwame Nkrumah, which is called the turret, is damaged, compelling the company to hold off production by another 2 weeks. Let's look at that statement as well. So this is a statement, and it says the technical investigation of the condition of the turret. And the turret you find on the FPSO at one end of the FPSO, saying that the turret bearing on the FPSO Kwame Nkrumah has confirmed that the bearing has been damaged and is no longer available to rotate as originally designed. Now, they go on to say that this would essentially mean that production, they would have to hold off production for another 2 weeks. And you can find that in the fourth paragraph, the third paragraph. It says, Talu currently estimates that production from the FPSO will restart in approximately 2 weeks' time and will also take time to ramp up. Talu's production guidance will be reissued once the new operating arrangements have been stabilized. All right, so now you know why you may be experiencing some outages wherever you are. And the explanation is that load shedding is not as significant or as terrible as it used to be last year. The load shedding that's happening could be around 50 megawatts. But as you heard the load management committee say, you should bear, Ghanaians have been asked to bear, and that the situation will be resolved in a bit. We're taking a break at this point. We'll be back with more. Please don't go away. Employment agency says it is exploring other alternatives to find sustainable jobs for volunteers who qualify after their 2 years training with the various institutions they are assigned to. Acting Chief Executive Kobna Beecham says the current arrangement will see the trainees being given training whilst drawing compensation, except not all of them will be integrated after their training. He was speaking to join us at the passing out of over 500 community policing assistants at the National Police Training School in Accra.
Out of the 26,933 online applications received, 3,180 Ghanaian youth were selected and trained under the Community Policing Assistance Program under the Youth in Security model of the YEA. The 527 graduates successfully completed the 5 weeks mandatory training in various policing procedures and techniques and are on a 2-year contract with the police service, after which some of them will be enlisted.
The program has been designed such that all the various partners, be it the Ghana Police Service, the fire, the prisons, or other partners, are involved in the selection. Okay, so because they are involved in the selection, because they provide the criteria, they are in the best position to choose the best possible recruits for their respective services. Okay, it has been designed such that at the end of the program, the police service will be happy not only with the caliber but with the quality, and then proceed to absorb them into the regular police service.
So is there a guarantee that this 6,000 people are going to be fully absorbed into the system?
Nothing on earth is guaranteed, okay, but on the balance of probabilities, a greater percentage, a significant percentage of all of them will be absorbed by the Ghana Police Service and other partners.
I'm wondering what then becomes the fate of those who will not be absorbed into the system. Doesn't it go back to the unemployment cycle again?
The program has been designed such that they will all receive an allowance from the Youth Employment Agency, okay?
After the 2 years?
No, for the period of the 2 years, okay? But during the period of the 2 years, okay, they will receive, a portion will be put into a fund, okay, and collected. So at the end of the 2 years, they will get a lump sum and then they will go into life with it. The expectation is that some of the skills, the discipline they acquire during training, if they are not absorbed by the Ghana Police Service, they can be used elsewhere, in security companies, in personal security, or elsewhere.
Are you the one facilitating that idea on their own after the 2 years?
Thanks for that idea. The Youth Employment Agency will explore ways of facilitating their integration into their employment.
Acting YEA Chief Executive Kobna Beecham spoke about progress made so far with the various modules.
The prisons and fire modules, recruitment is going on, okay, and it will be followed quickly by other modules. Youth in sanitation, youth in afforestation, youth in education, youth in health, there are quite a few.
The Greater Accra Regional Minister, Nilaye Afote-Agbo, also charged the new recruits to exhibit maturity and professionalism in the discharge of their duties.
By being a community policing assistant, I believe all of you have chosen the right path to your personal development. You must realize that you have the power to shape your future through serving in your communities, as well as your country as a whole, and harnessing your energy and education to create wealth and add value to yourselves.
Out of the 527 who passed out, 278 will be deployed to the Western region, while the remaining 250 will be stationed in Accra.
Management of the Tamale Teaching Hospital says it is going ahead with the privatization of laboratory services at the hospital. This comes a day after laboratory staff joined some clients to give the management 72 hours to rescind its decision. According to the public relations officer of the hospital, it has received 3 bids and will soon pick one to take over laboratory services.
I think if we say we seem to be ignoring the agitations or the concerns raised by the lab staff, it is not exactly so. They have sent in a letter with the management of the Tamale Teaching Hospital indicating their displeasure about the move to outsource some of the services within the laboratory. And management has received their letter and looking into it to, you know, come up with a position on the issue. But for the processes leading to the outsourcing, we just started the processes some weeks ago, and we haven't ended the process, graphic. And we invited this from internationally recognized laboratory service providers. As we speak, three of such organizations have sent in their bids, and we are yet to even open the bid. And once that is done, one of the companies will be selected. And when the company is selected, we would have to engage the company in a contractual agreement where we would come out clearly with the guidelines and the nitty-gritty of the very agreement that we want to have with the organization.
Well, the hospital says the reason behind the privatization is to provide a one-stop shop for lab care service devoid of challenges.
If you have been yesterday or if you have been today or if you have been tomorrow, so the issue of time, I don't think really is of great concern. But the truth of the matter is that we need to be able to provide a one-stop shop for our patients who visit us, because we have come to the realization that some of the services that the patients have access within the hospital, we are unable to provide them with those services. But with the introduction of an internationally accredited laboratory service provider into the system, we are sure that every service that we are supposed to carry out would be, every lab investigation would be able to, the patient would be able to access such lab investigations within the hospital without necessarily having to struggle across the length and breadth of the Tamale metropolis in search of lab investigation.
We're taking a break. When we come back, we'll bring you business news. Right, it's the time now for business, and Emmanuel Bajuyafi has joined me. Good evening to you, Emmanuel. Now, you know, I heard in the bulletin we're talking about the FPSO, the shutdown being extended by another 2 weeks.
Exactly.
Sure it would have implications for our revenue.
Obviously, I mean, if you have to, because remember it was off or it was shut down 2 weeks earlier than this one, so in all it's about a month. And especially when before then there were some intermittent shutdowns, and obviously it's going to affect the revenue generation as well as the revenue of the companies involved, like the Ghana Gas Company and others. You know, it's not a pleasant idea.
What else is coming up in business?
Well, in business, the European Union has threatened to slap heavy tariffs on companies, Ghanaian companies, if they fail to sign the EPA.
The EPA.
Yes, by October this year.
The EPA is back.
Exactly, it's back.
All right, you take it away.
All right, so the details. The fate of over 5,000 workers hangs in the balance as companies that export to the European market consider shutting down. This follows threats from the European Union to impose high tariffs on exports to its markets if Ghana and other ECOWAS countries do not sign the Economic Partnership Agreement, EPA, by October this year. Now, sources say the European Union is willing to allow goods from Ghana into its market if the country signs the Interim Economic Partnership Agreement. Some of the firms that export to the EU market say that the delay is affecting their operations. George Poye is corporate affairs manager at fruit exporting firm Golden Exotics.
For bananas, the tariffs that we have to pay is 19.4%. We do not come anywhere close to those margins. So if we have to pay such tariffs, we cannot exist. We may have to lay off workers and close down the company. We are hoping it will not come to that, but that is the problem we face.
Are you telling me that there is no plan B?
We believe that the right things and the decisions will be made on time, so it doesn't come to this. But the truth of the matter is that given the processes and the way these tariffs are structured, you have to pay up front before you even enter the market. You know, no business can decide to do that for a period of time. Maybe the first time you might pay, but after a few months, it is not possible to sustain that. So you may have to just...
The managing director of Pioneer Food Cannery, one of the major exporters of tuna to the European market, Nicole John Elizabeth, also says the delay is affecting the company's ability to attract fresh capital from its shareholders.
Basically, all the investments in the company at the moment is frozen. We have to think otherwise, maybe a plan B, because come 1st of November 2016, there is no way we can afford for our products to be entering the EU market with a duty of 20.5%. And we come nowhere close to functioning within this market, these margins of 20.5%.
Don't tell me that you might look at the option of asking people to go home or closing down the business here in Ghana.
We've been doing some stakeholders meeting within the company. We've been letting the people see this ahead of time. We would not want it to come to that, because that would mean more people affected, because our business is not only what's inside the company, it's also with people involved with us outside. We can say a multiplication of five, and that will have a big repercussion to the economy of the country.
Meanwhile, Joy Business is learning that ECOWAS as a bloc is delaying in signing the agreement, because Nigeria does not want to sign. The economic partnership agreement will allow Ghanaian exports into the European market quota and duty-free, with the exception of rice and sugar. Now, poultry farmers say the ban on importation of poultry products from Ghana's neighboring countries should go a long way to boost local production. The Agri Ministry imposed the ban on importation of day-old chicks, eggs, and other poultry products as part of measures to avert possible cross-border transmission of the bird flu disease. National Chairman of the Poultry Farmers Association, Victor Opongeji, tells Joy Business they have the capacity to meet local demand.
They already have everything at their disposal, and the only thing was they were not able to get good sales for their product. Mm. So now that there has been a ban on the DOCs from neighboring countries, it means they have to take advantage to expand their operations so that they can satisfy their local demand. At the moment, what we are saying is the hatchery operators, their incubators are already bought. They have them at their disposal now. So the only thing that was happening was they were not able to sell enough of the best. That's why they reduce the hatching eggs and sold them as table eggs. But now that there has been a ban on the one from the neighboring countries, it means they are not going to sell the eggs again. They will put them in the incubators to hatch them. So it will not make any difference. It is not bringing any financial burden on.
The Ghana Shippers Authority says it is working to address the transportation challenges faced by cargo trucks that the Ghana-Burkina Faso routes that ply the Ghana-Burkina Faso route. About 100 cargo trucks from Ghana are stuck in Burkina Faso, while 31 other trucks are also stranded at the Paga border. This is because of a decree Burkina Faso has passed, which prohibits truck drivers without a loading note from entering the country. Businessmen who ply their trade along that route are therefore unable to transport their goods. Chief Executive Officer of Ghana Shippers Authority, Kufim Bia, explains to Joy Business there are efforts to address the challenges as soon as possible.
Over 95 trucks are stuck in Burkina Faso. At the count as at yesterday, over 31 trucks are stuck at the Paga border. You know, in talking to our shipper complaints and support units in Paga, the information I receive is that the situation has not eased. It means that the 31 trucks are still there, parked in Paga, waiting to enter into Burkina Faso. All of this has come about because Burkina Faso has introduced a new decree. You know, and in that decree, they have introduced what they call the loading note or bon de chargement. And you are required to take the loading note at the port of Tema. It is free of charge, I must say. But if you do not take the loading note and then you get to the border, you cannot enter into Burkina Faso because you do not have the loading note. And by their decree, therefore, you have to pay a fine of 200,000 CFA. You know, and that has become a problem because the drivers would not want to pay the 250,000 CFA. The situation is made worse because our drivers also claim that they are not also permitted to bring cargo from Burkina Faso, and that in their location, the cargo is given to trucks originating from Burkina Faso. as against trucks originating from Ghana. Presently, we have taken cognizance of their decree. We are intervening to have them to suspend it and let the trucks move in the meantime. The Ministries of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Transport, they are putting together a delegation to go to Burkina Faso together with other stakeholders to meet with the Ministry of Transport, to meet with the Burkina Faso Shippers Council. And then we are hoping that as a result of those negotiations, we should get them to do something about the decree which is causing all of these problems.
Now, the United Nations University Institute for Natural Resources in Africa has lauded public-private partnerships PPP agreements in the agri sector. The current agreements, according to the Institute, are making a positive impact economically, especially on farming communities. This follows the release of the maiden report aimed at improving development outcomes of PPPs in agriculture and the environment. Speaking with Joy Business after the launch, consultant for the study, Dr. Richard Bonsi, said the country stands to benefit immensely if PPPs aimed at improving yields in the agri sector are prioritized.
The study sought to find out what outcomes, you know, have been there from PPP arrangements in agriculture and the environment. And so seven domains were studied. You know, one of them is, are there benefits economically? Are there benefits to society, communities, the partners, with respect to access to land, that is, when it comes to the farmers? Are there benefits with respect to environmental sustainability? And we identified that two of the domains are significant statistically, which means that there are major impacts, the economic domain and then the technological domain. Some of the communities have improved in using technology. They have adopted some new equipment, you know, for their use. For example, one community that is producing onions. The project introduced a prototype storage facility for them. And this facility has helped them store their onion. So, you know, onions' lifespan can be increased, and then they can store for a longer time and sell and get a good price. That is one. The other one that was significant is the economic domain, where we realized that there was a major impact in job creation. More people have jobs to do, more people earn income from the PPPs that are operating within their communities.
Finally, oil production on the Jubilee field has been halted since last month. This follows the shutdown of the Jubilee FPSO since the 20th of March and now extended by another 2 weeks. The development could negatively affect revenue the state earns in the form of taxes and royalties from oil exports, especially after such earnings for last year dropped by more than 60%. And that's how we wrap up tonight's edition of the business segment. Thanks for your company. My name is Emmanuel Abuaji Riafi. Good evening.
The Ghana National Association of Teachers is accusing the Finance Ministry of deliberately delaying the processes for members to be paid the arrears. The teachers called off a strike in February this year after they reached an agreement with government to allow for a validation of the documents of the beneficiaries of the allowances and arrears they were agitating for. Nat, however, says the Finance Ministry has failed to release the funds the team members need to scrutinize the thousands of documents they received. It says the validation team may suspend its work again by the end of this week as a result. Head of Compensation at NAT, Ahina Kwakwashi, highlighted the concerns on the polls.
Some of the teachers have been promoted, others have been recruited, and for some reasons, News of Finance said they only pay them 3 months out of their number of arrears, months arrears. So we said that fine. If you are going to pay and you say you're going to do validation, we don't have any objection. So they said we should go to offsite. We started this exercise on 29 February. Then on 13th of March, we had to suspend the exercise. for one reason or the other. Then we reconvened again on 29th of March, and then we have been told that they are going to break again on Sunday. Meanwhile, the exercise is incomplete. So we are seeing this as a deliberate ploy to deny the teachers their legitimate salaries. The first one, we were told they had some financial difficulties because they claimed that where we were undertaking the exercise was expensive. Then they took us to APAM. There again, they are claiming it's expensive. But they had the opportunity to select a venue that would have suited their pace. So I don't really understand. I don't get them. It's the only time that we had a government official, was a director of, a compensation at Ministry of Finance, who was there, last Sunday or so. Since then, nobody, apart from the chief executive of Fair Wages and Salaries Commission, who are coordinating the exercise, nobody, no minister has been there. We have not offered our premises.
Why so?
No, we don't. They are requesting for the validation, right? If they approach us and they say, oh, that we want your services to be put at our disposal, you will be obliged to do that.
The debate about which polytechnics in Ghana should be converted by government into technical universities is still raging, with the Bolgotanga branch of the Polytechnic Teachers Association of Ghana, POTAG, the latest to make their voices heard. The branch is of the opinion the piecemeal conversion of the polytechnics into technical universities will bring untold hardships to the remaining polytechnics, which set include the Bolgotanga Polytechnic. POTAG Bolgotanga is therefore appealing that instead of the current plan, all the polytechnics be converted into technical universities at the same time, while government takes steps to address the deficiencies identified in some of the polytechnics by the technical committee. Albert Sori has more from Bolgotanga in the Upper East region.
At a press conference at the Bolgotanga Polytechnic Thursday, the Bolgotanga branch of the Polytechnic Teachers Association of Ghana, POTAG, said if the polytechnics are converted in phases into technical universities, it will cause the ones left out to suffer in terms of admissions, staff turnover, and recognition. Florence Manamzo is chairperson for the group.
As a major stakeholder in the polytechnic community, POTAG was very much interested in the government pronouncement. However, the piecemeal convention will bring untold hardship to the remaining polytechnics in terms of admissions, staff turnover, and recognition.
Though the Bolgotanga Polytechnic appears to be in good shape in terms of facilities and space for expansion, it is one of the polytechnics that has been left out of the list to be converted into technical universities till later. Secretary for POTAG Bolgotanga, Maurice Brahma, says the Bolgotanga Polytechnic is better positioned for conversion into a technical university than some of the ones that have already been chosen for the first phase of the conversion.
We are calling on government for them to know that we have what it takes to run the tech programs. And we are also called with this press statement, we think that if they hear and they agree with us, we can also call for reassessment, just as Kekus and Tamale Polytechnic.
President of the Students' Representative Council, Asabia Abdul Rahman, expressed disappointment that the Bolgotanga Polytechnic has not been included yet among those undergoing the upgrade.
The committee report and the committee report is talking about the fact that some of the polytechnics have been converted against us. And when you look at that particular report, you realize that we are ahead of some of the polytechnics. You realize that we have a say, and they have to consider us. Another important thing is both polytechnics are part of the first five. But at the end of the day, they included both polytechnics, and now they have six is going to be converted. If that is the case, that means we can equally be converted as a technical university as far as our campus is concerned.
For Joy News, Albert Sori, reporting from Bolgotanga.
A bus conveying over 100 pupils of the Ministry of Health Basic School crashed into a house at exhibition in Dansoman in Accra on Thursday. Scores of the children had cuts on their heads. They were on their way to an excursion to the Kasua Mall when the brake of the bus they were traveling in failed. According to the driver, he had run the bus into a nearby wall to reduce any chance of injuring many people. The police have since towed the accident bus away from the scene.
I'm sure the school were going for an excursion. We were going for an excursion at West Homo. So we were inside and there was coming. There's a ramp there. I don't know if he didn't see the ramp or something. All of a sudden, he directed the car to the house, to the wall, the main wall, the fence wall of the house. Yeah. And just entered. So the walls are all broken down. Like, there was no any major injury. There's minor injuries on the children's forehead and all that.
When you say minor injuries, what does that mean?
Like just some little scars, but one particular girl is having serious headache. I think she was sitting in front.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, but so where are the children now?
Okay, they've entered another bus, Liberty Professional Bus, yeah, going back to the school.
I suppose they were traumatized in the life of
class. Yes, fears and all that. They had to give some children painkiller and all that.
But how many of them got injured? Are you able to estimate the figure?
Okay, the ones that came to me were like three.
Now, the Ghana Bar Association has condemned in no uncertain terms the conduct of the BNI in relation to what has become known as the SA3. The association, in a statement issued in Accra on Friday, expressed regret and grave displeasure at the conduct of the BNI in flouting the orders of the Circuit Court Accra, granting bail to the three former South African police officers. The Bureau of National Investigations, in spite of a court order granting bail to the three who had been arrested and detained by the Bureau, continued to detain them. The three had been brought to the country by the opposition New Patriotic Party to train the bodyguards of the party's flag bearer, Nanadu Dankwa Akufo-Addo, and his running mate, Dr. Mamadou Bawumia. They were, however, picked up by the BNI and charged with conspiracy to commit crime, unlawful training, false declaration, amongst others. When they appeared in court on Thursday, March 24, the Circuit Court granted them bail, but then the BNI whisked them, the three, into a waiting vehicle and sent them back to the detention center to the chagrin of their lawyers. In a statement signed by its president, Mr. Benson Nuchukwu, it said, "It is against the rule of law for any person or institution to flout the orders of a court of competent jurisdiction, especially under our current constitutional dispensation." We're taking a break now. Up next, we're bringing international news. Well, if you're wondering what's coming up on Join Us Interactive later on in the second hour of the bulletin, Ifwa Kwarising is here to tell us all about it.
Hello, Israel. Good evening.
Hi, Ifwa. I like your top.
Thank you very much. I like it too. I would tell people where to get it, but maybe after the show. But coming up on Joy News Interactive, food experts are warning against eating burnt food. Are you willing to let go of your favorite kanzo?
And it is not coming from any medical institution or from a medical board. We still continue to take it.
I love taking my kanzo, but if you know it is not good for consumption, don't even damn it. Yeah.
And did we speak too soon about the end of doom so we find out how your electricity situation has been so far?
Some of my subordinate at work is telling me it's back. And if it's back, then it's really bad. Yeah.
I don't really think it's over because sometimes we still experience it. For now, I don't know. We experience it once a while.
Please join us for more on the interactive segment of the news within the 8 o'clock hour, Israel.
And I know quite a number of people have had something to say about the doomsayer as well, like on social
media.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
So we'll be bringing you all that in the second hour of the bulletin. Please stay tuned. We'll be back in a bit. Well, to join us prime time now for a recap of our top stories. And the Load Management Committee is blaming ongoing interruptions in electricity supply on inadequate generation as a result of gas supply shortfalls, but has assured it the outages are temporary. Three persons, including a senior high school headmaster, have been arrested in connection with examination malpractice in the ongoing West African Senior Secondary Certificate examinations. The Ghana National Association of Teachers says the failure by government to release funds for the validation of claims by public teachers due some payment from government may compel a suspension of the process. In business, about 5,000 workers had to lose their jobs as the European Union threatens to impose higher tariffs on exports from Ghana and other ECOWAS countries should they refuse to sign the Economic Partnership Agreement by October this year. Enjoy news checks indicate recent claims by the Interior Minister that IT firm STL has been involved in the tallying of election results are untrue. In other news, Ethiopian Prime Minister Haile Mariam Desalegn has called for closer security cooperation between Ghana and his country to help address threats posed by terrorist groups and help restore peace in conflict-risking countries on the continent. Mr. Desalegn made this call when he visited the Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Center here in Accra, where the two countries signed an MOU aimed at providing a framework and guidelines for bilateral cooperation between the Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Center and the Ethiopian Peace Support Training Center.
Much has been done to improve governance across Africa, but there remains the real threat of terrorism, as well as significant pockets of instability. South Sudan remains in crisis, and there is also instability in Burundi. The Central African Republic is coming out of the wood, and in Libya, and a number of countries can be described as fragile. It is a matter of pride that both Ghana and Ethiopia has taken a leading role in helping to establish peace at various times in various countries throughout the continent. They have, as a result, accumulated rich experience of the difficulties and dangers involved. This, Excellencies, is why the agreement we are signed today, is of paramount importance. It will enable the peacekeeping training and institutions of both our countries to work closely together and to share experiences. The agreement will be a valuable element to help us build an effective peace and security architecture for Africa and an efficient and fully operational African standby force.
Now, the high penetration of the internet in Ghana has meant that many students have found their own ways of doing research which doesn't require them to walk into a library. Though this has resulted in a decline in the number of students who rely on libraries, there are still a significant number who still hold on to the tradition. In the following report, Joy News' Mahmoud Mohamed Nuruddin has been finding out why these students choose to visit old public libraries instead of turning to the internet for perhaps the same information.
The decline in reading among children is largely blamed on the advent of technology, especially the internet. Many believe this has made research a lot easier, though it has partially rendered the youth lazy. Public libraries, which over the years played significant role in building the knowledge base of the citizenry, especially student, appear to have lost their glory. But the story is entirely gloomy, as some few students in Kumasi continue to access public libraries.
I come here every day is that I get the necessary time to learn, and yeah, it is cool.
The main reason why I usually come here because this is the first, like, one of the area or the resource center when you want to learn at the nearest one around my area. That is the main reason why I used to come here.
Only four students are busily reading their books here at the Ashanti Library at about 10 a.m. So what's the motivation for the students?
I think the library is good because learning, and if you don't understand anything, you can just take some of the book and find a meaning. But in the house, you won't get it. It is, but on the internet, you might not find what you are looking for. And it's not that you won't find it, but when your attention gets to something different, like those who watch that satanic movies and pictures, if you see those things, your attention will be all lost, so you won't find what you are looking for.
Despite the enthusiasm, patrons are worried about the state of this library constructed several decades ago.
The books are okay, but the only thing they have to do, they are old ones and they need to change them, and times to the shelves too, like they are dirty and they have to clean it too.
Despite the provision of internet facilities in this library, patronage is still low and officials are concerned.
You can see about two or three people reading there. If the situation continues, it will really affect the library. It will really affect it. So that's why this, we also have some internet computer facilities to help readers so that they can also access whatever information they need. Instead of going outside, you can also access the same information here in the library.
The children's section of the library, however, appears to be different as it gets busy quite often. Joy News gathered most children select books on morality when they visit the library.
I came here to learn so that I can perform well in my examination.
Regional librarian Elizabeth Arthur is encouraging students to patronize the library because it provides conducive environment for reading.
We think that either because of the internet that they have on their own, I mean, they have their laptops, so we have e-reading. So sometimes those with the laptop who may decide to just go on net for the books. We have it there. But we are great. We have conducive environment for them. And apart from all these, they cannot also see a network.
The Deputy Director General of the Ghana Health Service has advised staff of the Ridge Hospital to do away with any form of rivalry and negative attitudes to work. Speaking at a send-off ceremony for the former medical director, Dr. Gloria Kwanza, advised health professionals to change that negative attitude to create a conducive atmosphere for patients who are in dire need of their service. Her comments come after long-standing tension at the facility over the appointment of Dr. Thomas Anaba as a medical director.
Dr. Thomas Anaba takes over from Dr. Emmanuel Obinyapuri as the medical director for the Ridge Hospital. Dr. Anaba's appointment was greeted with staff protest, citing incompetence and a breach in the selection process. The staff, with posters splashed on walls of the hospital, threatened a breakdown in service delivery if Dr. Emmanuel Srofenyo, popularly known as Dr. Srof, who was acting as medical director, was not appointed instead. The tension was, however, eased following his confirmation over 2 months ago. The Deputy Director General of the Ghana Health Service, Dr. Gloria Kwanza, urged the health professionals to maintain the peace and unity in the hospital.
We take some for granted. The human factor is very important. We can have the hospital, we can have the building. If the human relations are poor, we cannot achieve our best. So please, live as a family. I was watching when you were dancing. Sometimes when you go somewhere, they are playing music. Nobody will get up and dance. The atmosphere is very tense, but I can see the atmosphere is good. Please, live as a family. Do your work well. Attitude. We are always accused of poor attitude, bad attitude. Sometimes the person who is even the best behaved one day falls prey. So let's do our best.
Having served the hospital for almost 6 years, Dr. Emmanuel Obinyapuri, who is now on retirement, was honored by the hospital for his contributions towards healthcare delivery.
Dr. Thomas Anaba and the new management are taking over this hospital at a time of heightened expectations. Because they say to whom much is given, much is expected. You understand? So yeah, when we say that, it's the feathers that made the fowl big. The feathers today know that if you are not well stuck onto the skin of the fowl, when the wind blows, you'll be blown away. Which means that you must behave like a family. Together we stand, divided we fall. And let remember that, and please allow me to say this, the immaculate, imposing, impressive, and impeccable nature of this new building will be meaningless unless it is linked up with the total provision of excellent customer and client service delivered by a well-trained, healthy, and well-motivated staff in an environment that is safe for the patient and staff. True of all.
Other medical staff on retirement were also honored by the facility.
Up next, we bring you entertainment.
So KSM was here had multimedia.
Right.
He was actually with Doreen Andor on Cosmopolitan Mix. And he talked a bit more about the theater in Ghana. He says that, you know, people do not like quality. So the theater is dying. Theater is dying in Ghana, actually, because people don't like quality. And anytime you say you're putting together a play, people expect that it has to be humorous. So long as it's not comical, nobody wants to take it as theater.
Yeah.
And so we don't get the lessons that we need to get. Then he shared stories from back in his day as a radio presenter and things that he would actually
On Vibe FM.
Yeah, he said he was rowdy then. Now, if he gets the opportunity again, he'll like to take it easy.
You know, I still do the boogaloo, you know.
Yeah, the boogaloo.
Yeah.
But the boogaloo is you.
Really? Back in the day, I was very loud and very, very... And people still do that now.
Oh, yeah.
But I think, yeah,
a lot
I think...
Noise.
Yeah, a lot of noise, yeah. I'm beginning now to appreciate more than... appreciate more the quality of talking calmly, but the content of your argument is what counts,
yeah.
and not your yelling, you know.
Yeah.
So that's what I'll do differently now. I don't think I'll be loud. The problem with our general, not just movie scene, but even the stage, I think, I don't know whether it's the crisis in Ghana, I don't know what is happening, but during people really do not appreciate good drama unless they have to laugh.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're not going to make them laugh at anything, then don't worry.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost like we have a psyche that once it's called theater, it must be funny.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
So I think that's the challenge I'm facing. But I like how Ebo White does it, you know, because Ebo White does the deep, deep, deep stuff.
Amazing guy.
But he will inject it with a humor.
Yeah,
you have exactly.
Let me see it again.
Get the beat on. Now you gotta try to pet shoulders, knees and toes. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Pet shoulders, knees and toes. Pet shoulders, knees and toes. Pet shoulders, knees and toes. That's it. You got it.
What exactly is he trying to do?
Boogaloo. Is that a dance from your time?
You should stay away from it.
No, what was that?
You should stay away from dancing, KSM, please.
No, man. Israel.
Next thing you know, people have filmed you and they're putting you out there and you're going viral.
We filmed him already. Oh, are you trying to share your situation? Is that a testimony?
Let's move on.
Anyway, so you know the thing they say that once you're a female celebrity and you drive this luxurious car, you live in the fine house, you dress too nicely.
Yes, some big man got it for you.
Oh, you got the drift, you know.
Has some big man got in one for you yet?
I'm still waiting. I said I want a Jaguar.
Oh, yeah.
I hear they give out cars freely.
Okay, so, yeah, Miss G says she wants a Jaguar.
You've done the appeal for me. He has to come. Anyway, so we caught up with some celebrators called Kese Kwabna Kwabna and also Akofe Jane to find out if this is actually true.
You know, I've had experiences where women were giving the man. What I say? I have friends who, you know, I've seen people who have been taken by their women. So, I believe in this modern world, anything is possible. Woman can take care of a man, and vice versa. Yeah.
I feel that perception only exists around us Africans. I don't know, but I feel that out there, you go out with a lady, and the lady is also dipping out into her purse to also pay her part. You understand what I'm saying? But that doesn't happen around here. That's the reason why. We men of Africa attribute luxurious life led by ladies as in something which another man is responsible for, you understand? But for me, I feel a lady can be responsible for her luxury.
That's a misconception, you know. I'm not doing too badly, but I can't say that any man is helping me do what I do. You know, there are women who are achievers, who can do anything a man can do. How do they know it's not even that woman supporting the man? You know, people just have this warped idea of once a woman is doing well, then Some even go as far as calling women prostitutes just because they are achievers.
Is that perception true?
It is not true. It is not true. Maybe there's one or two who go whatever they go through that, but you cannot generalize it.
Well, but it's a debate that will go on. I mean, the people who are going to say that, the men are giving it to the ladies.
Maybe we should ask Lexis.
Okay, so Lexis has joined us, and Lexis is the host of Drive Time on Joy 99.7 FM, the nation's most listened to
drive
time show.
Yeah.
And thanks to the team, actually. Yeah. You make it so.
And Lexis drives the people home with his voice.
Oh, come on, be nice.
He's the man.
That's true.
You have a nicer voice. You know,
I'm a man. I can't sing that song. I'm not a man. So, you're the man.
Okay,
you know?
So Lexis is here to talk to us about
Walk with Lexis.
It's a fitness walk that's coming up tomorrow.
Tomorrow, that's what it is. It's a campaign. I mean, we need to get people living right. I mean, I've been working out for a little bit, and I've seen the benefits of it, so why not? I mean, let me get all my friends involved. Let's all walk.
You're a fitness freak.
Mm-hmm. You could say that.
You have a gym.
Yes, I do.
Somewhere at the Shalibuche.
At Shalibuche, the ex gym.
Oh, why are you looking at his chest? I thought you were going to talk about his chest.
What has my chest done?
No, I'm just looking at so he has a T-shirt on here. The walk with Lexis. T-shirt, and that was what I was looking at. The camera is
cutting. What he's doing.
Now, Lexis, be careful.
Yeah, well, right.
Be careful.
I'm trying to intimidate you.
So it's coming up tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow. So what it is we're getting as many people as possible to meet at the foot of the Bree Mountain. I mean, just around the Yemensah toll booth.
Yeah.
And we'll be actually meeting at the police station. We'll all walk. The Minister of Youth and Sports will be there, Neil Lantier van der Poy. Mm-hmm. He's leading. We have executives from Toyota Ghana who are supporting us from Graphic Communications Group, actually, from Puma and from Awake Mineral Water. Awake is making sure that everybody gets water and refreshed. Mm-hmm. And we walk up the mountain. And when we get on the deck, that's just opposite Pedjasa Lodge. We have big aerobics for everybody.
Okay.
Mass aerobics. You know, warm up a little bit, stretch here and there. And walk back down.
It looks like it's going to be a lot of fun.
Well, it will be a lot of fun.
You know, this whole thing started off with you. I remember it was on a holiday.
Yeah,
you went on the radio and I mean, as if you guys were kidding, and then you started, and people responded to it, and then you
now
took off like
it
that.
Is now actually
it's at the end of every month. After this one, we're doing at the end of every month.
After this month, we want it to be something. We don't want it to be a one-day wonder, or a nine-day wonder. Literally, it's going to be a six-day wonder or more. What we're doing is, at the end of every month, so the last Saturday of every month, everybody joins us, we walk up the mountain.
Right.
At least for, I know a lot of people who have not exercised in years. I mean, they haven't done any form of exercise in years. So I want this to be the only time that they can say, look, I won't miss this.
Yeah,
let me walk.
That one time that you
say
that.
One time
okay,
that you say,
I'm
look, I am going to exercise.
So at least each month, I took part in some exercise.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. And that's because now you realize that we have sedentary lifestyles.
Yeah.
A lot of us are seated in the office from morning till evening, stuck behind the computer. The only walk we'll do is from our car to the office, and when we close from our office to our car.
Yeah. I thought you said from one deck to the other. That's the only work we do.
Well, from one deck to the other.
In other words, from my Jaguar to the office.
Yeah,
and back to my Jaguar.
Yeah.
I saw what you did there. Okay, so Miss G told me you were bringing me my Puma boots.
Yes.
Yeah, so what it is our partners are Puma. So they've given us a couple of boots.
Okay.
And I think on the list, yours is coming on the next episode. Yeah.
Hey.
Oh, come on. No. I'm not taking this one.
You're even assured of it coming on the next.
I want my Puma boots right now. Because tomorrow I'm coming on the wall.
Okay. Then this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to give. What size you wear?
Give yours to him.
I wear 39.
It doesn't matter if it's oversized. Just put something in there.
Because
I wear a 45. I want to give you mine.
Oh.
You put something.
Paper. All right, so thank you very much, Lexis, for joining us. The Walk with Lexis fitness walk, it's coming up tomorrow at the foothills of the Bree Mountain. So are you Mensah at the toll booth there? So make a date, just be there. What time are we gathering?
5:30, 5:45. By then we'll start warm up, and by 6 o'clock
we're going up.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. So you do make a date, and that's it for entertainment. Wrapping up for Miss G. Up next, we bring you sports. Right, and that'll be all for the bulletin. Before we go, a quick run through our top stories. The Load Management Committee is blaming ongoing interruptions in electricity supply on inadequate generation as a result of gas supply shortfalls, but assures the outages are temporary. Three persons, including a senior high school headmaster, have been arrested in connection with the examination malpractice in the ongoing West African Senior Secondary Certificate examinations. The Ghana National Association of Teachers says the failure by government to release funds for the validation of claims by public teachers is due some payment from government may compel a suspension of the process. About 5,000 workers to lose their jobs as the European Union threatens to impose higher tariffs on export from Ghana and other ECOWAS countries should they refuse to sign the Economic Partnership Agreement by October this year. And Joy News checks indicate recent claims by the Interior Minister that IT firm STL has been involved in the tallying of election results are untrue. And then that'll be all for the bulletin. For more news, you can log on to myjoyonline.com. On behalf of the team, I wish you a good night and an enjoyable weekend.